Well, hello, welcome in. Whoever you are, wherever you are joining us online, I just want to say, I want to be the first one to say welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online Services. My name is Heath Hatmaker, and I'm the student pastor at the Rolling Meadows campus. And can I just say that if this is your 100th time, it feels like you've been watching online for 10 years now, or if you just got sent this link today and you're joining in for the first time, can I just say that we are so, so happy that you are joining us. We would love, I don't know if you know this already, but our staff is in the chat, wherever you're watching, and we would love to just know that you are here, where you're watching from. Just let us know. We would just love to interact with you there, and we just want you to feel as welcomed as you possibly can. So welcome to the service online. I'm so excited for today's service. I think it is going to be fantastic. One of the things I'm most excited about is we are starting a new series today that I can't wait for. It is called The Road to Reality. We're looking through the book of Romans for the next few weeks, and I am so excited about it. I'm excited because today we are going to be hearing from our pastor of biblical research, Dr. Mike Vanlaningham. I like to call him Dr. V. Dr. V is a fantastic friend and a resource to our staff. Before he came on staff at Harvest Bible Chapel, he actually taught the book of Romans, get this, for 20 years at the Moody Bible Institute. And so we are hearing a message today from a man who has studied and prepared and knows the book of Romans, and I cannot wait for you to hear it. It is going to be absolutely fantastic, and I just am so excited about it. I'm so excited to be together. One of our favorite things is just worshiping together as a family, and whether you're doing that, obviously you're doing it online, we want you to know that we're also doing it in person, and if that would be an option for you that would be best, we want you to feel invited. We want you to feel like you know what is happening. And so I want to remind you that we are meeting in person Sundays at 9 a.m. at our Rolling Meadows, Elgin, Crystal Lake, and Aurora campuses, and then Sundays at 10 a.m. at our North Shore campus and at our Cathedral campus. And it's just such a great opportunity to worship together. Whether you're in person or online, we're here together. We're worshiping together as a family, and I'm excited to do it today. Let's do it together right now.
See you. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine through the shadows. You win every battle. And nothing can stand against the power of our God. And almighty fortress, you go before us. And nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine through shadows, you win every battle, and nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before, and nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle, nothing
that song. When I see the ashes, God sees the beauty. That's so good to worship together. Welcome into our worship experience. My name is Heath Hatmaker. I'm the student pastor at the Rolling Meadows campus, and I want to welcome you to Harvest Online and just say that we are so glad, we're so happy that you're watching with us. And I want to say a special welcome to someone who is watching for the first time. I imagine that there has to be someone that just got sent a link or just randomly found the website or saw on YouTube. I want to say welcome to you. We're so, so glad that you are joining in with us. And one of the things that we do every single week at Harvest is we check in. And you can do that on the platform that you're watching on. You can use the link that was just sent in the chat, or you can download our app on the App Store, and we just want to check in. And all that is so that we as a staff know that you're watching with us, so that you could let us know how we could pray for you. We are, as a church, just one family. And so we want to be together. We want to know about one another, and we want to care for one another. And so checking in would be a great way that we could care for you even this week. And part of being in this family is giving. And so we have been giving every week. My wife and I give every week, and it is such a privilege to give our offering and see the way that the Lord uses it. And so I wanted to remind you of four ways that you can give. You've seen it already, I'm sure, but you can give online, you can see through the app, you can give through a text message, or you can give through the mail. You can mail your checks to the Rolling Meadows campus. And all that is just a way that we can be a part of the church together, and we can see what God is doing in this time. And one of the things that we're doing together as a church that I want to invite you to do as well is engage in our 21 days of prayer. And if you're not doing that yet, if you haven't started, can I tell you it's not too late? It's not something that's already passed you by that's not worth jumping in at this point. We have one more week of our 21 days of prayer together as a church, and it has been incredible to just pray these prompts to the Lord, asking Him to bless our church and to guide us. All of the information is at harvestnow.info, and we would love for you to join in there with us. Another resource that is right there at harvestnow.info that I wanted to remind you of, in the season that we're in with the election, with all the things that are going on in our world, it can be kind of confusing maybe to see how to live as a Christian. And our pastors have worked together on a guide that is at harvestnow.info called Living as Christians in an Election Season. And what this isn't is a like guide of who you should vote for, or how you should live your life when it comes to politics. It is a guide in how to live your life as a Christian in this season. And so I hope that you would be able to find that and use that resource. Our pastors have worked really hard on that, and it's really a great thing. So harvestnow.info there. And I'm going to pray right now. We just talked about the election season. I'm going to pray for our country and pray for our service as we continue. Let's pray together. God, we are thankful that you are trustworthy. You are a God that is in control, and we submit our country, our election season to you. We submit our time to you right now as we worship together. We pray that the Holy Spirit would come now, guide us, show us what it is that we need to see and need to know. And God, we love you so much. We're thankful for your son, Jesus, and it's in his name we pray. Amen. Come on, let's worship together.
Keep You're a miracle worshiper.
You are, you are, you are.
You keep your promises. Your promises are yea and amen.
Thank you, Lord. You're our living hope. You're our only hope. You're every hope. You're every hope I'll ever need. Every hope I'll ever need. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. When your weary body began to breathe, and out of the silence came a roaring, declared the grave has no claim on me.
Oh, Lord.
Cause you alone can rescue, you alone can save, you alone can lift us from the grave. And you came down to find us, led us out of death. To you alone belongs the highest praise. Yes, you alone can rescue, and you alone can save. You alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find us, led us out of death. To you alone belongs the highest praise. To you alone belongs the highest praise. And the highest praise is yours. Not just in a song, but in our homes. Not just in our homes, but in our hearts. You alone deserve the highest praise. Not just with a song, but in our homes. Not just in our homes, but in our lives. In our hearts. And our minds. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
What's up, Harvest? How are we doing? Grab your Bibles. Go to Romans chapter 1. And while you're turning, I want to tell you a story. It's a true story. The date was September 12, 1959, and it was the Island Garden Arena on Long Island in New York. It was a light heavyweight fight between two men, Henry Wallach of New York, and Bartolo Sani of the Dominican Republic. Now, this was an interesting fight. These two guys had fought 6 months before, and Bartolo Sani had won a split decision over Henry Wallach, and Wallach was furious. So it was a grudge match. Early in the fight, both guys came out, wild punches being swung. Nobody really ever landed any. In the third round, they came out, a lot of more crazy punches. They came in for a clinch, and the ref had them step back. And as they stepped back, Wallach started a punch that began in Wyoming, started way back here, and he threw it, but he missed. And the momentum and the force of the missed punch pitched him through the ropes. His head slammed on the floor of the ring, and he was knocked out at 2 minutes and 58 seconds into the third round. Now, to this day, the records indicate that Bartolo Sani scored a technical knockout against Henry Wallach, when in point of fact, Henry Wallach knocked out Henry Wallach. It's a great story. That's all I have to say. Let's close in prayer. No, I don't mean that. So here's the point. When it comes to our relationship with God, humankind is his own worst enemy. We deliver ourselves a knockout punch all the time. It takes us out of the ring so that we cannot be with God. And that knockout punch is called sin. One of the things that we find in the book of Romans is that there is a remedy for this spiritual condition that we have. And that remedy is found in the work of Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins. Now, for the next several weeks leading up to Christmas, we are, the preaching team is going to be sort of doing some dipping into the book of Romans. I guess we're going to be taking our favorite passages or something like that, and we're going to be looking at certain sections in Romans. This is not a verse-by-verse study. But as I've mentioned, that'll take us all the way up to Christmas time or thereabouts. The title of our series is Romans, The Road to Reality. One of the things that we're going to be looking at is just what is reality for us as Christians? What is true of us who have trusted in Christ as Savior? But also, what is true of unbelievers? And what do they need? How do they differ from us? How do they find the same kind of release from the consequences of sin, the guilt of sin that we've received? So those are the things we're going to be looking at over the next several weeks. Before we get any further, I want to talk very, very briefly about what Paul does in the book of Romans. What Paul does is he is basically reminding the Roman believers, he's writing to a church, these are Christians in Rome. In Romans chapter 1, verse 6, Paul says, you are called to belong to Jesus Christ, to all those in Rome who are loved of God and called to be saints. He's writing to believers. But Paul's plan is to go from where he is to Jerusalem, then to Rome, and then he's going to go to Spain. We know from Romans chapter 15, about verse 24, 25, he's hoping to stop in Rome to visit the church and that they would help him financially to be able to go to Spain. And so the book of Romans is written to this group of Christians to sort of clarify for them some doctrinal things, to sort of, by clarifying doctrinal things, to instill in them a new sense of urgency about needing to take the gospel, needing to help Paul take the gospel to Spain. And also, I would propose that when Paul shows up to be with them there in Rome, he and the Romans are going to be engaged in some evangelism in the city of Rome itself. And so Romans is, in a very real sense, we've probably never read it this way, but in a very real sense, Romans is a missionary support letter. He is writing to say, look, this is what we as Christians have, but the non-Christian world does not have these blessings, and it's our responsibility to tell them. And so he begins the book with some introductory words up through verse 15, but he starts in verse 16 in earnest, giving sort of a summary of, I think, probably just the first half of the book. But what we find here in verses 16 to 17, which is what we'll be looking at today, is that Paul is hoping that we will become more bold to share the gospel, and that we will if we can grasp two realities. Remember, this is Romans, The Road to Reality, right? And so here's the first reality. We're going to find that in the gospel, God exerts his saving power for us. That's in verse 16 and verse 17. In the gospel, we will see that God credits his moral perfection to us. And if we get this, I think it's going to help us be motivated to share the gospel. So let's take a look at verse 16. Paul begins in verse 16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. By the way, verse 16 and 17, aren't these among some of the really common verses that we memorize from Romans? You know, Romans 1, 16, 17, Romans 3, 23, Romans 6, 23, you know, Romans 8, 28, my verse. My favorite verse, Romans 12, 1 and 2, you know, the word living sacrifices. Well, I love these verses. And these are so important for understanding, really, almost the entire book. So Paul begins in verse 16 with the word for. When you see a little word like that, you want to figure out what it's there for. What he is doing is he is referring back to what he said in verse 15. He says, so I am eager to preach the gospel to you also who are in Rome. Now, he's going to preach the gospel to them, not because they're not saved, but because as they understand the gospel better, they'll be more inclined to get the word out themselves and to support him as he goes to Spain. And during our series here in Romans, all of us are going to be preaching the gospel to you guys too. Doesn't mean we think that you're unbelievers. Okay, so he is not ashamed of the gospel. He is eager in verse 15 to preach the gospel and teach it to and with those who are in Rome. Why? Because he is not ashamed of the gospel. The word ashamed is a word that means to experience or feel some embarrassment or disgrace because of some particular event or activity. It refers to sort of caving in to the fear of being ridiculed by people if they discover that we're Christians and we have trusted in Jesus. Now, I don't know how you guys are. I do not have the gift of evangelism. And I share my faith, and I enjoy doing so, but I have to tell you it's not the easiest thing for me. And there have been numerous occasions in my life where I have felt real tension and anxiety about the prospect of it. A number of years ago, we had a man from our neighborhood who's a handyman. That's all he does. He came in and did some repairs in our ice maker and our refrigerator. And he and I got to talking about some things, and he found out that I was a Bible teacher, and so we talked about Bible things, and I was able to share the gospel with him. Another time when he came back, our church was beginning to a series of special evangelistic activities. And I thought, you know what, I'm going to invite this gentleman, who I've already shared with, to go with us. And I was absolutely petrified to do so. No kidding. It kept me awake at nights, a couple of nights, thinking about it. I did finally invite him. He couldn't come. And I haven't seen him since. It's the last time I've seen him. And so if you are anxious sometimes, you feel nervous on occasion about presenting the gospel to people, let me tell you, I'm with you. We're in pretty good company. But I think we can do better than we often do, and we can be emboldened to do better than we often do. So, Paul explains why he's eager to preach the gospel to them. It's because he's not ashamed of the gospel, this good news. And then he uses the word for in the middle of verse 16 as well. And here he gives a reason why he's not ashamed of the gospel. It's because the gospel is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. All right, let's stop here for a second. Let's look at these words. The word power, really interesting word in the original language. It's the word dynamis, dynamis. And if you look at it, it looks like the word dynamite, doesn't it? And in fact, we get the word dynamite from this word. The thing is I've heard people actually preach it, that the gospel is the dynamite of God or something like that, and it blows up our lives in a good way. But typically, and I don't know a lot about dynamite, but don't you use dynamite to destroy stuff, to take things down and to take them apart? See, I think it's rather strange to say that the gospel is the dynamite of God. Why not use the English word dynamo? Or the gospel is the dynamic power of God, because that's the sense. This word refers to a mighty potency, power in action. There's other words that refer to power, something just has the potential for power, or power in some sort of a process. But this, as it's used here, actually refers to true power that produces and does something. Now, we're going to show you a picture of a wonderful car. This is an Aston Martin DB9, and it's a beautiful car. I love it. This car has 12 cylinders, and if you were to come up and ask me, does this car have power, I would say, oh, yeah, it really does. By the way, I just want you to know, I also have an Aston Martin DB9, and I would like to show it to you. This is it. There it is. That is my DB9. It was a gift given to me from a guy named Tim. That's mine. But the DB9 has 12 cylinders. And just sitting there, if you ask, does this have power, you would go, well, yeah. But when you actually press the ignition switch and those 12 cylinders fire up, and you drive down the Autobahn at whatever speed you want to go, or here in the Chicagoland at 55 miles an hour, you know what? That car has power. It's power at work. It's power that is doing something. And that's this word in this passage. The gospel has that sort of active, dynamic power, not just potential. It is the power of God, Paul says, for salvation. The word salvation was used in the ancient world for somebody being rescued from any certain kind of peril. It was used for a doctor helping a patient pull through from a serious illness. It was used for a lifeguard saving somebody who was drowning, or for somebody being rescued from a burning building. It carries the idea of a rescue. God has rescued us in Christ, but not from a building burning, a burning building, but from burning hell. By having Christ die for us on the cross, God rescues us from the consequences of our sins. More on that in just a second. It's the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. Let's talk about the word belief. The word belief carries the idea of total trust in and reliance upon somebody, what they've done for us. And we can count on them and rest in them. In this particular case, we put our faith in Jesus to rescue us from the consequences of our sins. Now, theologians will tell us that there are three different kinds or different aspects of faith, all of which go into making up saving faith. There is, first of all, the idea that we have to know the facts of the gospel. That Jesus of Nazareth, born of a virgin, God incarnate, who lived this perfect and sinless life, died on the cross for the sins that we've committed. And the beauty is that he is risen from the grave as well to demonstrate his victory over sin and death. But we have to understand those facts. And the second aspect of saving faith is that we have to believe that those facts are true, that they're for real. The third aspect of saving faith is that we ourselves must trust in Jesus alone for the forgiveness of our sins. We have to put our faith in him. And until we do that, we are not saved. Now, I want to stop here before I go on. If, in fact, being right with God, escaping the punishment for the sins we've committed and those eternal consequences, for us to be rescued by God, means that we have to trust in Jesus for the forgiveness of our sins. That doesn't happen automatically, even though Jesus died. That doesn't become ours until we put our faith in him. So I want to ask, have you trusted in Jesus alone for the forgiveness of your sins? Or are you counting on your church background, or the fact that you're a good person, or the fact that you regularly help old people across the street, or something like that? Those are good things, and we should be doing those kinds of things. But they are not sufficient to make us right with God, because even as we do those things, they are mixed with sin, and God is aware of those, and he does not tolerate sin. While he is a loving father, he is equally a just judge, and he will not simply let guilty people who have committed sin walk. We've got to trust him as Savior. I want to urge you to do that if you never have trusted in Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Now, this gospel is for everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. And so there's all kinds of questions. Well, what does that mean? Is the Jewish person, is he the first historically? Well, the word of God does come to Israel and the Jewish people first. That's one possibility to look at it. Are they the first in terms of missionary strategy? Sometimes Paul would go into a town on his missionary journeys. He'd go to a synagogue first. Could be that. I don't think so. I think the best idea is that they're first because the gospel is such an incredibly good fit for them. The gospel came to the Jewish people. It was forecast in the Hebrew scriptures. It is especially for them. Jesus is first and foremost, not only the Messiah of Israel. The fact that we get to benefit from his death. Now you got to hear what I'm about to say. It's weird. It's weird that we Gentiles, most of us, in the 21st century, in the Chicagoland area, are saved by the Messiah of Israel. It's weird, but it's wonderfully weird. It's gloriously weird. And it's something we ought to be praising the Lord for, that he was so broad-minded to enfold us in his redeeming plan, including us in the salvation that Jesus brings. All right, so here's the first point that we just looked at, that God exerts his saving power for us. As we begin to understand that, maybe that will embolden us. If only we could believe this, really believe this, I think we would be more inclined to share it with others and to overcome our sense of shame, our sense of embarrassment. Here's the second thing that might embolden us, hopefully, and that is that in the gospel, God credits his moral perfection to us. So he begins in verse 17 with another word, for. And here he explains why it is the gospel is the power of God for salvation. At the end of verse 16, it's because in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed. That's why it's the power of God for salvation. Now, what is God's righteousness? Let's talk about that just for a little bit. It's sort of one of those terms we know, we understand righteousness, but what does it really mean? God's righteousness is his moral perfections and his supreme virtue. Those are the same thing, his moral perfections and extreme virtue. In the Old Testament, we see God's moral perfections and extreme virtue in a whole bunch of different ways. God's righteousness is who God is in the Old Testament. It is one of his primary characteristics. In Psalm chapter 7, verse 17, you don't have to turn there, I'll read. It says in Psalm 7, 17, I will give to the Lord the thanks due to his righteousness, and I will sing praise to the name of the Lord, the Most High. God's righteousness is parallel to God's name. God's name is who God is. Sometimes righteousness is used in context with God to refer to his amazing deeds. In Psalm 71, verse 15 to 16, and in verse 19, the psalmist writes, my mouth will tell of your righteous acts, of your deeds of salvation all the day, for their number is past my knowledge. With the mighty deeds of the Lord God, I will come. I will remind them of your righteousness, yours alone. Your righteousness, O God, reaches the high heavens. You who have done great things, O God, who is like you? God's righteousness performs amazing deeds. Finally, God's righteousness in the Old Testament is connected to his saving of people. In Isaiah 51 and verse 5, God speaking, my righteousness draws near, my salvation has gone out, and my arms will judge the peoples, the coastlands hope for me, and for my arm they wait. Notice his righteousness draws near, both to save and to judge. All right, so what is God's righteousness that's available to us in the gospel? It's his moral perfection. It's a supreme virtue. And the astonishing thing is that when we trust Christ as our Savior, God counts us as possessing that righteousness ourselves. He credits that to us. He reckons that to us. It's like a bank account. We don't have any money, but God makes a deposit there. And he sees us as righteous in Christ. A couple of passages on this. Go over right to Romans chapter 3. And in verse 21, Paul says, but now the righteousness of God, same phrase, has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. So we see God's righteousness here manifested to us, made available to us when we trust his Son. Take a look at chapter 4, verse 1. What then shall we say was gained by Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? And here Paul cites Genesis 15, 6. Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. When we have faith in Christ, God counts us righteous. He imputes, he reckons us his own righteousness. By the way, we need that. How could we possibly hope to be able to be in eternity with God if we were to get there on our own righteousness, which, as we already said, is tainted with sin? And the amazing thing as well, in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 30, it says, because of him, that is because of what God has done for us, you are in Christ Jesus, who has become to us wisdom from God, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. So when we trust Christ, God counts us righteous. He views us as having his own moral excellence, his supreme virtue. And on the basis of our union with Christ by faith, that includes even the righteousness of Jesus that's counted to us. I'm here to tell you guys, that's really good news. That's why we need to trust in him for salvation. For in it, that is in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed. It's made manifest from faith to faith. Now, there's all kinds of questions. What is this faith to faith? I almost never say this in a message, but I'm going to tell you guys now. I want you to write this down. What is faith to faith? I'm going to tell you. Ready? Here we go. Nobody knows. Nobody knows what that means. I'm just going to tell you that right now. You read through all the major commentaries on Romans, you know, you read through 15 commentaries, you're going to get 18 opinions on what that means. Here's what I do know for sure, is that all of the benefits of Christ, including this righteous status before God, credited to us, comes through faith. However else we understand the phrase, faith is the key for us to trust in Jesus. Now, I think the word from faith to faith, where the ESV says from faith for faith, I think the idea is this is just a way of saying it's by faith from top to bottom, from start to finish, back to front. It's by faith alone. There's no other way to be able to encounter and receive this righteous standing before God. And then Paul goes on with the scriptural evidence for this, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. Now, this is from Habakkuk 2:4. If you go back and read through Habakkuk 2:4, you're going to say, I don't really see how this relates to Romans chapter 1. Here's the thing. In Habakkuk chapter 2, the whole book actually, the Babylonians are coming to destroy Judah under the providential and sovereign hand of God. And Habakkuk knows that the Babylonians are a super evil, wicked people. And Habakkuk struggles with how God in his providence can use a super wicked people like the Babylonians to come and destroy just sort of a little bit corrupt and wicked people of Judah. Habakkuk doesn't get it. And so what does God say? My righteous one will live by his faith. That is, Habakkuk, you got to hang on to me in the midst of all of this. You can't figure all of this out, but I'm in charge. I'm going to bring about the way things ought to be. You hang on to me by faith. Now, the point that Paul is emphasizing here is a point we should not miss, and that is the key to faith, the key to one's relationship with God. Whether we're trying to go through hard times and difficult situations or to get saved, the key is always faith. In this context in Romans, the key is faith in Christ for salvation. In Habakkuk, it's faith in the Lord and his promises to eventually someday deliver and bless Israel, even though it didn't appear that that was going to happen. And so it's from faith to faith, as it is written, the righteous man shall live by faith. Now, we know that Paul's using this as proof that this is how a person gets right with God. In Galatians chapter 3 and verse 11, for example, Paul uses the same word, the same verb, verse Habakkuk 2:4, again in Galatians chapter 3. Now, it's evident that no one is justified before God by the law, for the righteous shall live by faith. So we have, again, he uses Habakkuk 2:4 to indicate how one becomes right with God is by trusting, by having faith in Christ for salvation. Now, as we've already mentioned, I really hope and I really pray that as we become aware of these things, as we understand these things, as we look at the gospel as this incredible dynamic power to change people, to change lives, maybe we'll become more bold. I want to suggest 2 points of application for us here. First, I want you to think back to when you became a Christian. I want you to think of the person who was not ashamed and told you about Jesus. Maybe it was a parent or a friend or a pastor or something. And what I want to suggest is, if they're still alive, and if you know where you can get a hold of them or dig around a little bit, you can probably find them on the web. Send them a note, an actual note, a note like that you would write on stationery and put in an envelope and lick it shut and put a stamp on it and send it off to the United States Postal Service. You remember those? When we used to do those things, right? Let me tell you something. They get a letter from somebody like you or me that says, thank you for not being ashamed all those years ago. Thank you for telling me about Jesus. It's going to be an enormous blessing to them if you do that. I just remember the girl who witnessed to me. Her name was Diane. I was, maybe you can tell, a loudmouth, arrogant, nasty jock when I was in high school. And on the first day of junior class, into homeroom walks this really cute girl, and I thought, oh, I got to get acquainted with her. And I don't believe in evangelism dating, but I asked her out, and she went out with me several times. And I'm really glad she did. Every time we went out, she told me about Jesus. And I thought, stop already, stop. It was making me sick. I was totally freaked out. But I'll never forget the first time she said to me the word Jesus. I remember where I was and where I was sitting. And it struck a chord in my heart. And Diane, she's shy. She was really shy. She was bold enough to talk to a crazy jock like me. It was on Friday, July 14, 1972, in front of her house with several other friends, where we'd had a Bible study, and the objective of the Bible study was to get Vanlaningham saved. At 6827 18th Avenue Northeast, at about 11:30 at night, Friday night, I trusted in Christ as my Savior. I am so glad. Diane and Larry and Larry and Amy and Robin were not ashamed. So glad. Kent Hughes, in his commentary on Romans, has a great story. He writes, the day after Pearl Harbor, Alan Emery, like thousands of others, enlisted. He chose to be in the Coast Guard and was immediately put to work in his hometown, Boston, as a quartermaster, and was given the Friday night duty of guarding one of the wharfs. On one Friday night, while he was resting before his duty, one of his new buddies named Joseph Olszewski, kind of a hard name, Joseph Olszewski, came in dressed immaculately in his dress blue uniform, his hat squared, his shoes spit-shined. He gave Emery, who was a Christian, a really big smile. Said, how do I look? Olszewski said that he had met a beautiful, wealthy young woman at a meeting the night before that she had invited him to her apartment on Beacon Hill to spend the weekend with her. She had tickets to the opera, lots of record albums, lots of alcohol, and Joseph Olszewski was thrilled about the arrangement. He didn't have to be back until 0700 on Monday morning. And he ended the story by saying, "This is going to be the greatest weekend of my life." Alan Emery, the believer, said that he would be praying for him. His friend walked out, but immediately re-entered and said, "What did you say?" "I said I'd be praying for you," replied Emery. "Why are you going to be praying for me when I'm about to have the first great weekend in my life?" "Because, Joe, Monday morning you'll be back aboard ship, and you will not be the same person you are tonight. Sin leaves its mark." Joe swore at Emery and went out into the night. Emery prayed for Joe as he prepared for guard duty, and he was startled when an unsmiling and agitated Joe suddenly appeared in the lights of the guard post hut. "How can you have a good time when someone's praying for you?" he said. "You've ruined my weekend. I stood at my date. I've been waiting until you came on duty. Now tell me, how do I find God?" And so that night, Joseph S. Olszewski heard for the first time in his life the promises of God in Christ, and he believed. The change in his life was immediate. He joined the Park Street Church in Boston and grew tremendously under the ministry of Dr. Harold Auchengay. He spent his free time inviting other servicemen to services, prayed with his buddies, and became quite a go-getter for the Lord. Then, on February 1st, 1943, Joe Olszewski volunteered for sea duty on a minesweeper headed for Iceland, and just a few days out of New York, a torpedo sunk his boat, and he perished. That was 77 years ago. 77 years, Joseph Olszewski has been in the presence of Jesus. And I think if he could stand here right now, he would be so, so grateful to Alan Emery for not being ashamed of the gospel. We need to pray that we won't be either. Let's pray. So, Heavenly Father, help us to get it. Help us to see the gospel as that thing that you use to rescue people. You have used the death of your son and the message that's entrusted to us to provide the kind of power that we need to be right with you. Father, we are so grateful for what you've done, but I pray that our gratitude, Lord, would deepen and that it would spur us on to even more boldness so that we could tell about what you've done for us to rescue us through your son. When you came down and how you died for us, your son, upon the cross. God, thank you. Thank you. Would you help us not to be ashamed? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Who, oh Lord, could save themselves? Their own soul could heal. Shame was deeper than the sea, but your grace is deeper still.
Let's sing that again.
Who, oh Lord, could save themselves? Their own soul could heal. Our shame was deeper than the sea, but your grace is deeper still. 'Cause you alone can rescue, you alone can save, you alone can lift us from the grave. And you came down to find us, let us out of death. To you alone belongs the high.
You, O Lord,
you, O Lord, have made amen. He alone can save. What a great message for us this week, and a great challenge for us. The first stop on the road to reality, second stop coming next week. We're praying for you. Have a great week. God bless you. You are loved.